Tonight in Top Gear, as the last of the Capris reaches the showrooms, we look back on the British public's 18-year love affair with Ford's unlikely sports car. We dip into discounts. What can you get off a new car, and how does it compare with the other deals on offer? And we drive the latest mopeds. They may look better, but are they really any improvement on their predecessors? But let's start tonight with Britain's continuing success story, the Jaguar, because they're about to launch the new Sovereign onto the American market. Not entirely without risk for two main reasons. One is because the existing car, the Series 3, is doing so well. The Americans love that shape. Will they like this one as well? Mainly because that market is dominated by the heavyweight Germans, including the Mercedes, of course, and more recently the new BMW 735. So how will the Sovereign rack up against the opposition? Well, the only way to find out is really to enter this exclusive world of motoring, at least for a while. So we took the three cars to the rough and tough and bumpy roads of beautiful North Yorkshire. The Jaguar is the cheapest of the three cars at around £25,000, and it should be the cheapest in America too. Jaguar already sell over half their production in the US, so the American launch is vital to the company's continued prosperity. In its basic form, the BMW 735i costs about the same as the Jaguar. But the options are expensive, and with a special equipment package on this car, the price goes up to almost £32,000. Mercedes are by far the most successful importer of luxury cars into America, and this long wheelbase 420 is the cheapest S-Class petrol model they sell there. But with its expensive options, it comes out at around £35,000, so you could buy a Jaguar and a Golf GTI for the same price. The Mercedes is the oldest of the trio. It first came out in 1979. But it's a tribute to its design, perhaps, that it still manages to be lighter and have a lower coefficient of drag than the brand new Jaguar. The 4.2-litre V8 engine produces 218 brake horsepower, and despite the size of the car, it really pushes it along. The steering is light and responsive, and on most surfaces the ride is first class. But the car is noisy. There's a lot of wind and tyre noise. On these rough Yorkshire roads, the car was a real handful. A car for the city and the motorway, rather than for diving down country lanes in. And although Mercedes' quality makes other manufacturers envious, I have to say that our car suffered total electrical failure during the test. By any normal standards, of course, all these cars are superbly put together and magnificently well-equipped. Everything a driver could want is here. But on the direct comparison with the other two cars, I think the interior of the Mercedes really lets it down. Everything's here, the clear instrumentation, the matched wood veneer, but somehow they managed to achieve an old-fashioned, even austere look, perhaps added to by all this black plastic on the fascia. The big wheel, I think, gives a sedate feel, added as well by these big, flat, overly sprung seats. The great strength is certainly the amount of legroom, certainly in the front, and of course the magnificent build quality. Now the BMW is a very good-looking car, I think, both outside and in. A great deal of thought has obviously gone into the design of the new 735 interior, and for my money they've produced a cockpit that's really quite difficult to beat. Looks classy, feels comfortable, is ergonomically sound, everything's at your fingertips, also has a high-tech feel, which I think is mirrored in the quality of the equipment installed. It ranges from, for example, a comprehensive trip computer to a complete diagnostic system. Altogether, I think a very good cockpit indeed. Now, with the BMW, you've really got to watch the speed limits because it's a bit like holding a tiger on a leash. It develops only fractionally more power than the Mercedes, but the remarkable thing is the speed and smoothness which that power becomes available. Add to that the stiffness and the muscularity of the suspension, and you've got a real driving machine. Now, the steering's tied into a variable servo mechanism. Basically, that means that you get a lot of assistance at low speeds, so it's easier to move the car around and park it, and the assistance falls off as the speed builds up, which means you have to work harder, of course, but the payback is you get much more feel through the steering wheel. Perhaps the most disappointing thing about the big BMW is the amount of tyre noise, and indeed wind noise, surprisingly high for a car with such a low coefficient of drag. The Jaguar just goes on surprising you with its quality. You squeeze behind the wheel, you put your right foot down, there's this deep-threaded purr from up front, and the car literally glides forward. The ride, there is no doubt, is by far the best of the trio, just swallows up the bumps and all but the roughest roads and stays flat and square on the road. And quiet too, by far the quietest of the three cars. My grouses, such as they are, concern the steering, which is too light. You can just wind it on at speed with scarcely any feel at all. The boot is a trifle small for a luxury saloon, and the single windscreen wiper can't cope with a downpour at speed. But overall, this car from Coventry, there is no doubt, is a real humdinger. The feel inside the Jaguar is really quite different from the other two. You don't actually sort of sit on the seats, you sit into them. You get a much more wrap-around sports car feel. You're drenched in the smell of leather. Some journalists even claim they can smell the wood veneer. I don't like, I must say, the combination of old-fashioned dials and modern-type video screens, nor do I like very much this thin steering wheel. But I love the idea of the J-gate, which separates completely the automatic mode from the manual one. And if value for money counts at this level, then you certainly get much more for much less with a Jaguar. You get a standard, for example, air conditioning, these leather seats, self-leveling rear suspension, a trip computer, six-speaker stereo, all in the standard price. So very good value for money at the luxury car level. So how does the Jaguar compare with the opposition? Well, the short answer has to be very well indeed. In some cases, it beats them hands down, notably in terms of the quality of ride and that value for money. And all the signs are it should really carve its way into the American market. But out of this selection of motor cars, is it possible to pick the best of the bunch? Well, let's face it, all three represent the very peak of motoring. In many ways, they're very closely matched. In acceleration and performance, for example, they're virtually identical. If you want a soft, safe ride along well-made roads, then the Mercedes offers that in abundance. But if you want superb equipment and a first-class drive, then it has to be either the BMW or the Jaguar. They're both superlative driving machines, with the BMW, for my money, just having the edge. But enough of luxury and self-indulgence. Let's move now to the other end of the transport scene, namely to the humble moped. Humble, but it costs only a few pence a mile to run. Sue Baker has been looking at what's on offer.
Well, this lovely old thing is probably what most of us still picture when we think about mopeds. A bit clumsy, rather tricky to learn to drive at first. Extremely economical, but not the prettiest of lines. However, mopeds have come an extremely long way in the 73 years since this one was on the road. And here at the Star Rider National Motorcycle Centre in Birmingham, we've brought together a collection of the very latest in mopeds. Legally, a moped must be no more than 50cc and governed to 30 miles an hour. You can ride one at 16 with L plates and a provisional licence, but car licence holders are qualified for a moped without L plates or any further test. The number of mopeds involved in accidents has gone down over recent years, but there are still nearly 3,000 riders killed or seriously hurt each year, so training's important. Most dealers will deliver a new moped direct to a local training centre, where a novice rider can have 4 hours basic instruction before venturing out onto the road.
These are typical of the wide variety of bright-coloured, smartly styled mopeds you can go out and buy today. Now, this one, the Suzuki CP50, is a little unusual in being a two-seater. Rather nice, that. You can take a pillion passenger with you. It's also rather handy in having an electric starter. Now, that's a feature that a number of mopeds have these days, and it does make them much more convenient. The Kawasaki AR50, on the other hand, is a rather more sportily styled machine in bright, aggressive colours. That's designed to appeal to the young lad and make him want to get onto a moped. But it will still only do 30 miles an hour because, by law, mopeds have to be governed to that speed. This one, the Honda Mini Vision, is obviously much more designed to be a little urban runabout for use for shopping or commuting. It's painted in colours that the marketing men apparently think are going to make it appeal to women. Well, I'm not so sure about that. But the Yamaha FS1E here, that's just recently been reintroduced to the market to attract young lads back onto mopeds. A rather attractive-looking machine, a motorcycle look about it more than a moped, and I think that might just attract a few of them. But all these bikes range in price from just over £400 to just over £700. And if that's just a bit much for a youngster trying to afford their first bike, well, if you shop around, you should be able to find a decent second-hand moped for about £200. And the great beauty of them is how cheap and economical they are to run. The running costs are reckoned to be, in normal use, under £1 a day.
Mopeds are not difficult to learn to ride. If you can ride a bicycle, you can quickly master the basic techniques of one of these. The trickiest part is gear changing, operated on this Yamaha by the lever under the left foot. The little Honda, though, is much easier. It's an automatic. Used sensibly, all of these machines felt perfectly stable on the road, even in the slippery weather conditions we experienced. It is important to be kitted out with the right kind of clothing, for safety if you're unlucky enough to come a cropper, and in these conditions, for weather protection. To sum up, a new moped costs from £300 to £700. Insurance is up to £40 a year, and road tax is £10.
Now, one of the facts of life of the car industry over the past few years is that more cars have been made and there are customers to buy them. Bad news for the car makers, of course, but quite good news for the motorists, because it means the dealers are really falling over themselves to offer discounts to lure us into their showrooms. But how can you be sure the deal you're negotiating at the moment is a good one? Well, to find out, we sent Frank Page, always, of course, on the lookout for a bargain, to find out what kind of discount you might expect and what alternative inducements might be on offer.
When you want to change the family car, do you look forward to entering the showroom, or is it more like a visit to the dentist? It need not be traumatic, because the buyer is still king, and discounting, despite the industry's denials, is still rife. This week in Birmingham, for example, Ford dealers were offering 9.6% off Sierra 1.6Ls and 9.4% off similar spec Sapphires. At a Vauxhall outlet, you could get 9.8% off a Cavalier 1.6L saloon, though only 4.3% off the popular Carlton 1.8L. At Austin Rover dealers, there was 10.6% to be had off a Maestro 1.6L, but the Montego 1.6L ranged from 5 to 8% off, according to the dealer. Volkswagen agents were into double figures, giving 11% off the Golf 1.8 GL 5-door. If you don't want to haggle for a discount, how about a deal on the servicing? Like this one being offered by a Yorkshire Nissan dealer. Mrs. Muriel Birch lives in Eldwick, near Bingley in Yorkshire, and for the last 5 years she's run a Talbot Sunbeam. Now she's decided to buy a Nissan Micra from DC Cook. Mrs. Birch, why did you choose this scheme?
It seemed a very good idea, very good scheme for people that are retired and on pension.
Retired people don't do a lot of mileage in the first place, that's our assessment of it, and we can allow for the odd one that does. And also, pensioners tend to look after the cars.
Now, a customer could actually, by using Yellow Pages or shopping around, get a very hefty discount on a Nissan. Would he actually do better than coming to you?
Absolutely not. The deal with the pensioners is no different. We're still prepared to give the same deal to a pensioner that we would give to someone else.
But does the deal only cover routine servicing?
No, it's a complete additional benefit. It covers the full servicing cost for 5 years, and we will also put on tyres, exhaust, or absolutely anything. The only thing that the pensioner has to pay for is for the road tax and the insurance and obviously petrol.
But you don't have to be 65 to join the scheme. Even those who retire early on a company pension are eligible. Don Smith from Yeadon near Leeds has just retired, though his wife Sylvia is still working. They are considering buying a Bluebird.
The cost of servicing over the years will add up, and for 5 years free service, that's a big thing in my position.
Will you be doing a very high mileage?
No, I don't anticipate doing a very high mileage. Might do 10,000 a year.
And had you looked around to see if you could get a discount on this or a similar car with other dealers?
I've not gone into discounts too much with the other dealers. I've had a look at other cars and compared prices and what they had to offer, and I think this has got quite a lot to offer me.
But would the pensioners do better with a straight cash discount? If Mr. Smith paid list price for his car, it would be £9,174. We rang the dealer's Chesterfield branch and were offered £1,000 off that for cash. But Fleet News reckons that over 5 years you'd pay at least £1,370 for servicing the Bluebird. So it does look a good deal for the retired. But it's early days to judge. We'll be keeping an eye on how it goes.
If you, like me, don't have the advantage of being retired, but you have squeezed a discount out of the car salesman, then he could offer you a servicing deal such as this gold card. Under this scheme, you can budget for all your servicing costs over the next 3 years. But you do have to have an accurate assessment of your annual mileage, and you have to have all the servicing work done at the group's garages.
If you bought a Ford Escort 1.6L and contracted for a mileage of 36,000 over 3 years, you'd pay £22 a month. Increase that to 60,000 miles and you pay an extra £10. Costs for an Austin Metro 1.3L five-door are £18 and £31 a month, respectively. A Vauxhall Cavalier 1.6L estate, £23 and £32. But suppose you break down where there's no company garage handy.
Any driver who has our gold card would phone in to our maintenance controllers. We have a team of maintenance controllers at our head office. They would state their registration number. We would immediately see who was the driver of the vehicle and the history of the vehicle, and we would identify the fault and then point the driver in the right direction for getting the job remedied.
But if the motorist is making these monthly payments to you, isn't there a chance that that will add up to more than he would have to pay if he just paid for his own routine service and repair bills?
No, not really, because as far as we're concerned, we purchase a high number of the various items that are required to keep vehicles on the road these days. For instance, we'd buy in excess of 10,000 tyres a year. We operate a fleet of over 5,000 vehicles on contract hire. And therefore, we are passing on that purchasing benefit to the man in the street. So he's actually getting paying a lower price for the item than he would have done as a normal walk-in customer.
Is it such a good deal? Working on the figures from Fleet News, yes, if you anticipate travelling 12,000 miles a year. All the company's figures are lower than the magazine's estimated costs over 3 years and up to 36,000 miles. But look at the 60,000 miles. The gold card scheme is slightly above the Fleet News figures in two cases and considerably above for the Metro. Your car is monitored during its service life to check you don't exceed the contracted mileage. If you come close, the payments will be increased or the contract terminated at the set figure. To sum up, both these schemes are new and relatively untried. As a customer, you need to check your service costs because only you can tell whether schemes like this will actually save you money or merely give you peace of mind.
Well, we've mixed mopeds with Jaguars so far in this programme, so why not a tractor? And up here in Yorkshire among the small hill farms, you can still find a fair few tractors like this around. 20 to 30 years old, still doing a hard day's work, perhaps the most electronic thing about it being the ignition key. But down in the valleys, of course, where the wealthier arable farmers live, there are plenty of big modern tractors around with enough electronic gadgetry on board to make even the car makers blush. Chris Goffey reports.
A typical spring day in the depths of the Warwickshire countryside. Now, motor manufacturers are always telling us how sophisticated their computer systems are becoming. Down here on the farm, the humble tractor is receiving computers that are far more advanced than anything BMW or Jaguar have yet offered us. This is the Massey Ferguson 3080, the last word in tractor sophistication. It's fitted with no less than three computer systems: Datatronic, Autotronic, and Electronic Linkage Control. It's even got its own radar system. The electronics fulfil two functions. One's to help the operator control the machine and stop him making errors. The computer, for instance, engages and disengages four-wheel drive according to road speed and land conditions. And it also prevents the operator from selecting the wrong gear or damaging the implements by incorrect use. The information systems are equally sophisticated. The computer takes in information on speed, power, fuel consumption and wheel slip, and it works out on the touch of a button the rate at which work is being done, the cost factor of operating the tractor, taking into account fuel, running costs, and even depreciation. Thus, if the driver decides to go faster to cover some land before dusk, for instance, the computer can show just how much or less it's going to cost the farmer. And with the economic pressures on farming that he's experiencing at the moment, that sort of information can be vital. Why does it need radar? Well, obviously, ploughing under the sort of conditions we're experiencing today, the wheels spend an awful lot of time slipping in the mud. The computer needs to know exactly how fast the machine is moving forward over the ground, and it compares that to the speed each wheel is turning and thus engages or disengages the four-wheel drive systems and the differential locks to give ultimate pulling power and economy. It also automatically raises or lowers the implement it's pulling to lighten the load on the tractor and thus reduce wheel slip. Farmers are a pretty hard-nosed lot. They tend to be very conservative and not impressed by gimmicks, but they've taken to the sort of performance onboard computers can give them far more readily than the motor industry. It's one area where the executive, flashing along in his BMW, is left far behind in information technology by the tractor driver he so contemptuously passes.
Now, this next item is a rather sad one because it marks the demise of a car that perhaps surprisingly has long been a favourite of the British motorist. It lasted for 18 years, despite constant predictions about its imminent death. It sold in large numbers in the face of hostile reviews from the motoring press. It's become the definitive motor car for the upwardly mobile suburban teenager. Sue Baker reports from the graveside.
Ford's Cologne factory in December, and the very last Capri, number 1,886,647, leaves the line. One of a special edition of 1,000 farewell Capris. All the photographers, though, are British, because although the Capri was only built in Germany for the last few years of its life, the car was designed and mainly bought in Britain. The early prototypes looked very aggressive. Ford of Britain wanted their own version of the successful Mustang sports car from America, but they were eventually toned down until only the heavy rear three-quarter panels were left, and they were changed when the rear passengers couldn't see out. So the final car had the characteristic U-shape to the rear windows, which was to stay with the Capri to the end. And the commercials played on the idea of the Capri as an affordable sports car with passenger and luggage space as well.
Ford Capri, the car you always promised yourself, from £890.
We were trying to seek out a market opportunity between the boring saloons of the time, the Hilmer Minxes, the Vauxhall Victors, and the and indeed Cortinas, yet at the other hand recognizing there was a tremendous desire for people to own things like Jaguar E-types and Ferrari fixed head coupes. That was the sort of market we wanted to go for, a cheap affordable car with all the looks and pizzazz and probably poser value of a Jaguar or a Ferrari. Basically, we started from the Cortina. We were given an objective of spending £40, which isn't very much money, £40 on styling the car so that you can sell it for no more than £80 to £90 more than an equivalent Cortina. And as you know, the Capri came in at £890, which was about £90 over the Cortina equivalent.
It was always intended as a family car. It is a four-seater, well, just about, but with a very strongly sporty flavour. Short, stubby little gear stick, a cluster of instruments, and all this matte black inside. More important, it was a sporty car from the outside with this long, swept line, the fastback tail end, and this lovely long bonnet. Ah, but it didn't actually need a bonnet as long as this. The engine didn't take up anything like all the space under the bonnet. In fact, some people called this a Cortina in drag or a sheep in wolf's clothing. But it wasn't all about image. Ford had motorsport in mind with the Capri.
And Clark is adopting the race driving tactics of all time as he throws that Capri about as though it's a matchbox. And feeding the car through to those...
A four-wheel drive version was planned from the start, but in spite of success in rallycross, the road car never materialised. Ford said the four-wheel drive system took up too much of the limited interior space. And exciting race we've ever seen. Capris dominated the European Touring Car Championships in 1971 and 72. The cars were RS2600s, developed by Ford of Germany to improve the Capri's sporting image. Their reign was short. They were defeated in 1973 by a wealthier team from BMW. With the RS3100, Ford of Britain tried their own racer, seen here at the company's Dunton Test Track in Essex. Launched at the same time as the first fuel crisis, only 250 were sold. The fuel crisis mood also affected the Capri's replacement.
5 years after its launch, and with more than a million of them by now on the road, the Capri was revamped and the Mark II came along. Now, in keeping with the trend of the early 1970s in the post-fuel crisis era, cars were becoming more practical and with less sporty overtones, and the Capri went the way of the trend. It became a hatchback. All its sporting overtones were diluted. The emphasis shifted to it being much more of a family car, with a tailgate, with a folding rear seat. The interior was toned down and the whole flavour of the car changed. And they coined a new marketing phrase to match it, the once-in-a-lifetime car.
But sales were disappointing as buyers were not impressed with the new sober Capri. Meanwhile, older cars were enjoying more success as transport for the urban hero.
So macho, he's gotta be. So macho, he's gotta be. Big and strong, enough to turn me on. He's gotta have big blue eyes. Be able to satisfy. He's gotta be big and strong.
For a real driver's car, though, the Capri buyer had to wait until 1981. The new injection, with its 2.8-litre engine and torter suspension, turned the Capri back into a desirable car, even though its wet-weather grip wasn't quite as good as the advert suggested.
It goes like...
The injection model was really a great success in rejuvenating interest in the Capri, both as a performance car and as a racing machine. And so it triggered a lot of special versions with modified bodies and engines, like the Tickford, with its very lavish interior, lots of leather and walnut, with its turbocharged 2.8-litre engine, its special suspension, and its very heavily modified bodywork. This car is the Swaymar 2.9 Turbo. It has 285 brake horsepower from this turbocharged engine, and they say it'll do at least 160 miles an hour, and with a 0-60 acceleration time in well under 6 seconds. It has the bodywork to match, all the lovely fared-out wheel arches and this beautiful colour-keyed paintwork. In fact, altogether, it's really quite a mean machine.
So, with all this new interest, why does the Capri have to go?
Basically because the demand has moved into hot hatchbacks and XR3s and Golf GTIs and Peugeot 205 GTs. We ended up basically selling an 18-year-old antique at the rate of 1% of the British market, 18,000 cars a year, to a very loyal owner body, most of whom are very disappointed we're not replacing Capri, and there are 18,000 buyers out there at least who would like to see some sort of Capri come back.
But I can't see Ford producing a new Capri for only 18,000 buyers a year. So, if you must have one, £11,000 will buy one of these last 280 specials.
Well, that's all for this week. Next week, we're back at the same time, same place, 8 o'clock on Tuesday. We've got a very interesting report on relationships between the motorist and the police. We've got a look at two budget-price family cars, the Hyundai Pony and the Seat Ibiza, and an all-action report on the sport of off-road four-wheel drive trials. So see you then. Until then, drive safely. Good night.
There's a new series starting here on BBC Two on Friday.
So, they are reopening that disco, are they?
What's it called? What's it called this time?
The Ritz.
Wait till you see the sign. The Ritz.
The Pits.
The Ritz.
You're gonna need some door staff, Eric. Stop the riffraff from coming in. You're gonna need some very good bouncers.
I know.
There's been no trouble, has there?
No. Not yet.
Oh.
You close this place tonight, and you walk. You carry on, and you wake up with doctors all around you.
But Eric and his team are determined to open the Ritz Friday at 9:30 here on 2.